So have you ever seen static in your vision that almost appears like tiny white and black, sometimes colored or translucent dots that just sort of quickly move and shimmer, blanketing everything that you see in your vision? This is sometimes analogous to the static or snow that people would see on older television sets when it was set to the wrong channel. If so, then what you have experienced may be the symptom of visual snow. For some people, visual snow can be really, really mild, like barely something that they can see and appreciate and usually doesn't affect their life very much. But it can also swing the other direction, being super extreme, and then people have a hard time reading, they don't feel safe while driving, and it can affect their other daily activities. And this is something that I have. I've had visual snow since as long as I can remember, since I was a little kid. And thankfully for me, it is extremely mild. But even right now, as I look around the room, I can see this subtle blanket of static on everything. And again, I've seen this as long as I can remember. And I honestly thought that everybody saw this way. It wasn't until later in my life, as I had more questions and had the ability to better describe my visual experience, that I started to figure out that not everybody has this same kind of static in their vision. So that's one of the reasons why I wanted to bring light to this topic and talk about this. As in today's video, we're going to not just talk about the symptom of seeing visual snow, but also the diagnosis of what is called visual snow syndrome. With my big hope is that if you are watching this and you think you also have the symptoms of visual snow or visual snow syndrome, that you will be better armed with the right words to describe what you're going through, whether it be to friends and family, but definitely to healthcare professionals, as we will learn in just a moment, this is a very misunderstood condition. Which is in fact one of the more frustrating things about this condition is that many eye doctors and even neurologists have never even heard of this condition. It is so new that many people just don't really understand it or know truly how to diagnose it. In fact, 10 years ago, when I was in optometry school, many of my professors had a hard time understanding what type of symptoms I was trying to describe to them. I even would open my textbooks at that time and couldn't really find anything that really matched what I was describing, because largely the first diagnosis of what visual snow syndrome is wasn't even described until about 2014. So it's still considered a very new thing. But thankfully, since then, a lot has come out in the realm of research around visual snow syndrome. And at this time, to get a diagnosis of visual snow syndrome, and I say at this time because things can always change in research, but at this time, to get a diagnosis, you first have to have the experience of this symptom of visual snow or seeing the static in your vision for at least 3 months. And then, assuming or in the absence of any other pathological cause, you need to have two of these next additional symptoms, which include that of palinopsia, enhanced entoptic phenomenon, photophobia, or nyctalopia. And I know some of these terms may be completely new to some people, so I'm going to kind of walk through and give some visual examples of what they look like. Palinopsia is where you see persistent trails of moving objects. So imagine waving your hand back and forth, and you would instead see a constant motion of trailing hands and arms moving back and forth along with it, of where your hand kind of just was. This can be really disturbing and makes things like imagine driving really difficult. Photophobia is often used as the term to describe that of light sensitivity for people who are really bothered by bright lights. And I actually did a whole video on photophobia and talking about the different treatments for that. So if that's something that you know bright lights bother you, then check out below in the description. I'll put a link to that video below the like button for you. Otherwise, nyctalopia is the term used to describe people with night blindness or people who just have a hard time seeing in dim light. And then there is the symptom of enhanced entoptic phenomenon, which honestly is a bit more elusive to describe, but I do happen to have this, so give me a moment to do my best to try and kind of simulate and describe what this looks like. Now, probably the best description I've ever read of enhanced entoptic phenomenon was describing that it's the enhanced perception of normal physiological functions of the eye. This includes a couple of different things, one of which is the ability to see the blue field entoptic phenomenon, which is a whole other topic that we've actually done a video on. So again, I'll put a link to that in the description below. But in short, that's the ability to see these very fast-moving, almost white dots off in the periphery of your vision, usually while looking at a blue sky. Science has shown us that that's actually white blood cells moving very quickly through the vasculature in the retina inside of the eye, and just because white blood cells are larger than red blood cells, that it kind of creates a different type of focus and shadow effect in the vasculature, and so you start to perceive them. But people with enhanced entoptic phenomenon may be more hyper aware and perceive this blue field entoptic phenomenon a little bit easier. In addition to that, people with enhanced entoptic phenomenon may also be more hyper aware of their eye floaters. We've talked about eye floaters in a lot of other videos on this channel, but in short, again, they are a normal thing to experience as they are just accumulation of collagen clumps in the gel of the eye. But people who have, again, this enhanced entoptic phenomenon, they may be more hyper aware of these moving kind of shadows of this collagen gel shifting inside of their eye. There's also the symptom of having persistent after images in your vision. This is sort of like looking at a desk sitting across the room, and then you turn to shift and look at your best friend's face, but you still see this after image of the desk floating, kind of overlying this image of your friend. And so you can imagine that can be really disturbing at times. And then enhanced entoptic phenomenon can also show up with almost like these drifting, subtle clouds of colors in your vision. This is something that I do experience. And even when I was young, I knew if I closed my eyes, I would see these gently wafting kind of colors kind of move around. Later on in my life, as I did more of things like meditation and yoga, I think became more even hyper aware and was starting to realize I can see these drifting clouds of colors even with my eyes open. Again, for me, it's all very subtle, but it is kind of interesting to see and perceive these things. Now, in addition to all of these visual symptoms that we've just described, some people also have secondary visual or non-visual symptoms. Most commonly is that of a tinnitus symptom. Tinnitus is like a ringing in the ears. It sort of sounds like this, which is, again, something that I've experienced since I was a little boy, but thankfully, for my case, is very mild. Some people also have a history of migraine. In fact, a history of migraine is strongly associated with visual snow syndrome. Some people also experience photopsias, which are kind of like sparkles of light that you can see and perceive in your vision. And then some people even have hyperacusis, which is like a hypersensitivity to sound. And then you can even have balance disturbances and even tremors. Now, I know we've covered a lot of things already, but I do also just want to add here that some people may experience these other symptoms constantly, while some people may experience them only intermittently or maybe worse during a flare-up, meaning that some things may trigger some people's symptoms to get worse or perhaps wax and wane. I just want to mention this because visual snow syndrome can be rather complex, and I just want people to understand that not everybody's symptoms will be exactly the same. So now that we know what visual snow syndrome is, you may be asking, well, what causes visual snow syndrome? Well, unfortunately, at this time, we still don't fully understand what causes it. But generally, it is believed that it is more of a central brain-related visual processing disorder due to hyperexcitability of the visual cortex, meaning it's more of a brain visual processing issue and less of an eyeball issue. Some people have this from when they were born, which we refer to as primary visual snow syndrome, or they've had it as long as they can remember. Like myself, there's not a time in my life I can remember where I haven't had these types of symptoms, where other people can acquire visual snow syndrome later on in life, which we call having secondary visual snow syndrome, which can occur after a multiple of different types of events. Many things have been linked to developing visual snow syndrome, which include, but is not entirely limited to, that of having head or brain injury, having a bad infection, such as maybe a systemic flu, a GI infection, or even having like an upper respiratory tract infection, having increased intracranial pressure, having history of chronic headaches or migraines, and then even for some people having consumption of alcohol, hallucinogenic drug use, and even just taking some medications have been known to trigger this for some people. And then there are also some comorbid conditions that people can experience. Things again like migraine, also anxiety and depression, there's dizziness, there's fibromyalgia, and then there's even POTS, or postural orthostatic tachycardia syndrome, which is a bit beyond this video, but something I just definitely wanted to add. Now, for myself, and maybe this goes for some of you who are watching this video, if you happen to also think you have visual snow syndrome, you may notice that sometimes your symptoms can be triggered, or again, they can flare up in a way. And there are several things that have been reported to maybe cause flare-ups in their symptoms. This can include things like stress, lack of sleep, even taking some recreational drugs like taking marijuana, or perhaps even taking caffeine can maybe trigger this sort of response. There's also some connection with headache and even neck pain. I know for myself, as I mentioned in the video on migraines that we did, for me, if I sit with really poor posture in front of the computer, or if I'm laying on the couch playing a video game or something for a length of time, if my neck is in a bad position, that can also trigger my migraines and my symptoms for visual snow to be worse. It's also been reported that some medications, like treatment for like antidepressants and even migraine treatments, have been known to sometimes trigger and make symptoms of visual snow worse, or sometimes can even help symptoms for some people. But I think it's just good to be aware that some lifestyle factors can trigger your symptoms for visual snow. Now, in order to properly get a diagnosis of visual snow syndrome, the diagnosis is largely based on the description of having these types of symptoms, as there's no real objective measurement or way to test for having this condition. You usually do have to see at least an eye care professional, a neurologist, or a physiatrist, or perhaps a whole team of different specialists in this area. Getting a full comprehensive eye exam, which may include getting a macular OCT scan, which is a way to kind of scan the retina to make sure that everything's intact and healthy. Also a visual field test, which is a way for us to map out your side vision and make sure there's nothing else kind of more neurologically going on within the eye or within the brain. It may include electrodiagnostic testing, as well as getting tests for like an MRI, a CT, or a PET scan. Largely all of this is just done to kind of rule out that there's nothing else going on with the eye or other pathologies happening going on within the brain. Now, if you're watching through this and you're like going check, 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 like everything we're talking about is something that you have experienced, then I think probably the easiest doctor that you may be able to get in to see is probably an eye care professional of some kind. And I think starting there is not a bad idea, just to rule out that there's nothing going on wrong with the eye, right? They can at least evaluate that. And then assuming everything's normal, they hopefully would be able to refer you to a neurologist or some other specialist to kind of take it from there. Okay, so I know this video has already gone long enough, but you're probably wondering, what are the treatments, right? Are there any treatment options for visual snow syndrome? And that is a whole other topic I do want to cover. And so we're going to be covering that in the next video. In fact, I'm going to be bringing on a very special guest from an expert who has a lot more experience in managing and treating things like visual snow syndrome than I do. So again, it's going to be a really special video. For that, please, I'm going to ask you to do the YouTube thing and subscribe to the channel if you haven't done so already, and turn on the little bell icon, because then it'll notify you when our next videos come out, and you definitely don't want to miss that. Otherwise, I do encourage you, connect with us in the comments section below and other people who are also experiencing these symptoms of visual snow. I think that'll be a great way to connect with everyone. Also, I'll put some additional links in the description, including some helpful resources such as the VSI, which is the Visual Snow Initiative, which is a nonprofit that provides not only resources, but education, and helps raise awareness around visual snow. Thanks so much for watching. Again, Dr. Allen here. Keep an eye on it, and we'll see you in that next video.